Thank you very much, Ellen. Good evening, everyone. The construction sector is one of the more important economic sectors in the world. Actually, the budget of the construction sector is close to 8.2. Is it possible to switch off the lights, maybe? Thank you very much. Thank you. Wonderful. The actual budget of the construction sector is close to $8.2 trillion, let's say, dollars, and it's expecting to increase up to $15 trillion, let's say, by 2025. It is one of the more important, let's say, economic sectors in the world. And the construction sector is very much associated with important, let's say, environmental and economic benefits. And in particular, of course, the budget is very high, but at the same time, the construction really represents almost 13% of the global GNP in the world. And this is expected to increase up to 15% by 2020. At the same time, construction offers a lot of labor, a lot of work. And especially after, let's say, agriculture is the more important, let's say, sector offering, let's say, jobs to the world. Actually, we believe that we have almost 180 million people working in the construction sector. But if, let's say, informal workers are taken into account, and especially in India, the total number of people working in the construction sector may be more than 250 million people. At the same time, construction is, let's say, a multiplier factor. And actually, you know, for each position or each, let's say, specific work in the construction sector, there are three additional jobs generated in the global economy. So there are many, let's say, important benefits associated with the construction sector. But unfortunately, on the other hand, there are many important problems associated with the construction sector. And let's say, an important problem that we have to discuss today and tonight, it has to do with the energy consumption of the building sector. Actually, buildings represent almost, let's say, 38-40% of the total energy consumption around the world. And this number may increase in the future, but we will see it together. On the other hand, construction is, let's say, responsible for environmental management. Actually, construction, let's say, is responsible for about 40 or 50% of the raw materials in the world, and also is responsible for, let's say, most of the waste and most, let's say, of the pollution around the globe. Also, construction and buildings are responsible for the so-called climatic change. About 38% of, let's say, CO2 emissions are coming from the construction sector. And also, because of the very high density of our cities, we're facing the problem of urban heat island, where temperature is increasing in our cities with important, let's say, environmental and economic problems. But the more important, actually, and this is a huge challenge for the construction sector, is that we have really 1.6 billion people living in informal and non-adequate, let's say, housing. About 863 million people living in slums. And it is believed that by, let's say, 2020, we will have 1.2, 1.3 billion people living in slums. Just to understand, let's say, the dynamics of the informal construction, about 20 to 30% of the global urban growth in the world, it is associated with the informal, let's say, construction. And this is not just a problem of the non-developing or the non-developed world. This is a problem of the whole world. Actually, in the developed countries, we have about 200 million people living under energy poverty. However, the more important problem we are facing, it has to do with urbanization. Actually, we have something between 3.5 billion urban people, and we expect that by 2050, the number, let's say, of the urban citizens will increase up to 6.3 billion people. So the construction sector has really to find, first of all, adequate housing for 1.5 billion people living in slums, and also has to prepare, let's say, the infrastructure for 4 to 5 billion of additional people that we expect up to 2050. These are the major challenges of the construction sector around the world. And of course, all these problems are very well known. And there is a very rich dialogue which has been developed during the very last years in the construction sector, trying really to identify the problems, put the priority on the problems, define an agenda for the future, and so on. But it is very well accepted that, you know, all these problems are very much interrelated. And to design and implement a specific policy about the future and, let's say, the possible solutions for the construction sector, there are some conditions. And the condition which is really very, very important, and we have to go through that, is to understand the nature of the problems. I'm afraid that we don't know exactly the problems. The second thing, it has to do with, let's say, the objectives we have for the future. I'm afraid that we don't have very clear objectives. We don't have very clear targets. So we have to discuss about, let's say, the actual conditions, and we have to discuss about our future targets. And for sure, the problems are global. But we have to think in a local way, because there are so many differences between, let's say, the different areas, even for the same, let's say, exactly problem, that we have always to identify the specific conditions in a specific place. And the whole issue, it has to do with the capacity of the societies to implement proper policies. And this is really determined by various factors, which includes the strength of the problems, which is very important, the local economic conditions. The same solution may not apply, for example, in a poor country or in a rich country. The development prospects, how much a solution may really contribute to develop the area. The technological competence, do we have enough, let's say, of technology to apply? The availability of the technological tools, and the more important, the economic and the business models that we are using. It is impossible, really, in about an hour to discuss about the whole spectrum of the problems. We have to put some priorities. And the dialogue that has been developed during the very last years has agreed that the major problems that we have to face in the future deal, first of all, with, let's say, the future energy consumption of the building sector, not the actual energy consumption of the building sector, the future energy consumption of the building sector, the association of the built environment with climatic change, global and local climatic change, and third, with the problem of poverty. So I will try really to go through all these issues and to analyze, first of all, the political, economic, and technical context which is associated with the characteristics of the energy consumption. Second, we will try really to analyze the impact of the global and local climatic change on the building sector, and vice versa, of course. And finally, we'll analyze the technical and the social aspects which are associated with energy poverty. We have to understand, and this is extremely important, that these three sectors are strongly interrelated and present very significant synergies. And it is very important to understand that the existing policies applied all around the world, which aims to reduce the energy consumption of the building sector, usually underestimate the impact of climatic change and underestimate the problem of energy poverty. And unfortunately, failure to consider all issues in an integrated and in an holistic way really results in higher energy consumption and more social discrepancies. So it's an holistic problem and has to be, let's say, faced in an holistic way. And let's start with energy. If you really plot the energy consumption per person around the globe, you will see, for example, that in the States, we have a consumption which is very close to 9,000 kilowatt hours per square meter per year. You may tell me, so what? Is it high? Is it low? No. The problem is not the absolute consumption. The problem is the difference. actually in Asia, excluding China, the energy consumption is less than 2,000 kilowatt hours per square meter per year. And so what? We know that in the United States they consume more. The problem is not the absolute number. The problem is the difference. And the problem is the difference because this defines, let's say, the dynamics of the future energy consumption. This number will increase there. This is the main problem. And many people believe that the energy problem is a technological problem. Not at all. Not at all. There are several drivers which define really the magnitude of the energy consumption. And the main, let's say, parameters that really has to be considered and really define the energy consumption in the world has to do, first of all, with the family income. You may be surprised, but this is the major, let's say, parameter that defines the energy consumption. Climate, the population size, the energy efficiency, the equipment price, and the cost of energy. How? To measure the impact of the different parameters on the energy consumption, we are using the so-called elasticity. Elasticity is a parameter that defines, for example, how much a certain factor, for example, let's say the climate, affects the energy consumption. An elasticity close to one means that when, let's say, the climate is increasing by 1 degree, the energy consumption is increasing by 100%. Or something like that, or let's say the equal amount. So you may see from the existing elasticities that income, climate, and efficiency are the more important of the parameters that really affect positively the energy consumption. The higher the income, the higher the energy consumption. The climate has a very high elasticity, a high impact. The same, the energy efficiency. You may be surprised. The higher the energy efficiency, the higher the energy consumption? Yes. Because when the energy efficiency is increasing, people is buying more, let's say, systems. And so the energy consumption is increasing. On the contrary, when the price of the equipment is decreasing, the energy consumption is decreasing, and the price of electricity also contributes to decrease the energy consumption. And let's take one by one and be comprehensive. We are discussing about, let's say, climatic change. Okay, so what is the energy consumption that, let's say, we face because of the temperature increase? When the temperature in the world is increasing by 1 degree, the energy consumption of the building sector is increasing by about 14%. When the temperature is increasing by 2 degrees, the energy consumption is increasing by about 34%. And when, let's say, oh my goodness. And when temperature is increasing by 3 degrees, then the energy consumption is increasing by 55%. So there is an important impact, a huge impact of climatic change, local and global, on the energy consumption of the building sector. Second parameter, second factor. The potential impact of increased income. If we plot actually the availability, for example, of the air conditioners in the world as a function of the GNP, of the income, you will realize that the higher the income, this is exponential, almost exponential. The higher the income, the higher, let's say, the saturation of the air conditioning. And when really we plot the energy consumption and at the same time, the occupied space per person as a function of the income family, you will see that the higher the income, the higher the square meters per capita, the higher, of course, the energy consumption. So the income is affecting highly the energy consumption. Why? Because we buy more equipment, and second, because we have, let's say, bigger houses. And what is going to happen in the future about, let's say, the future GNP? If we plot, let's say, the existing forecast, you will see, for example, that we are somewhere here. And this is the expected increase of GNP for the United States. This is for Europe. This is for China. And this is for the world. You will see, for example, that we expect a huge increase of the GNP of the income in the United States and a very smaller increase of the income in the rest of the world. So what? It affects very much the energy consumption and creates a dynamics. As I told you before, the predicted average income, you know, in the world for in 2050 will be something close to, let's say, $9,200 of 1990. And the maximum will be in the United States close to $55,000, while in Africa it's going to be close to $1,190. So the differences increases in the future. And this creates an important dynamics regarding the energy consumption. And this creates a tendency to occupy more space. If we plot the occupied residential area in the world, actually we are very close to 200 billion square meters. We expect by 2030 this will increase up to 300 billion square meters. And in 2050, we'll move close to 370 billion square meters. You understand, and it's easy to understand, of course, that the more the occupied space, the higher the energy consumption. On the other hand, the average housing area per person, it is something close to 24 square meters, let's say, per person in our days, and will increase up to 30 in 2030, or close to 37 in 2050. And this may have a tremendous impact also in the energy consumption of the future. And the expected increase of the total residential area between 2005 and 2050 is 500%. And it is easy to understand that this has a tremendous impact on the energy consumption. The same happens also for the commercial sector. The total area which of the commercial, let's say, business, it is something close to 24 billion square meters. In 2030, this will increase close to 30. In 2050, will increase close, let's say, to 37. So more commercial area, more energy. And this is the average, let's say, area of the commercial sector per person. You see that there is a very, let's say, important increase expected for the future. And of course, this increase will not happen in the developed countries. Will happen in the underdeveloped countries or in the developing countries. And take into account what I just showed you before, that the absolute energy consumption there is low, the energy consumption in the commercial sector and the residential sector will be skyrocketed in the developing countries. And the real problem is there. The third parameter that is affecting the energy consumption, it has to do with the increase of the population. These are the forecasts, you know, for the increase of the population up to 2100. And you may see that in Europe, let's say in Australia, in North America, we don't expect any important increase. But see what is happening in Asia. See what is happening in Africa. And see what is happening in the world. Let's say this is the low scenario that for 2050 predicts, let's say, a population close to 9 billion. This is the best we may have. The average scenario, which is very probable, will give us, let's say, about 11 billion. Now we are very close to 6. And of course, the high scenario will give us something close, let's say, to 12 billion. So we have to host, let's say, 6 billion people. This is the worst case. 6 billion people, and we need buildings, houses, residential buildings, commercial buildings, and energy. And let's try to forecast a little bit the energy consumption for the future. All the existing studies, it shows that really the energy consumption for heating will, let's say, be stabilized up to 2050, 2100. Why? Because of the climatic change. We have, let's say, higher temperatures, and the energy consumption for heating will be stabilized. Also, the increase of the population will happen in areas with low heating consumption. But if you try really to forecast the energy consumption for cooling, it is a skyrocket, let's say, consumption. And if we try to put together all the studies about the future energy consumption, we are very close to zero. This is the consumption for 2030. You see that in Europe, we expect an increase of the consumption, mainly because of the Eastern countries. But see what is it's expected in 2050, especially for China and India, and see what are really the forecasts for 2100, especially for India and China. Who is going to deliver this energy? Which kind of energy is going to be, let's say, used? Coal, oil, gas, at which price? Who has these amounts of energy? What about pollution? What about CO2? What about climatic change? The actual scenario that we are using in our days, if applied here, the CO2 concentration, which is actually about 400 ppm, will move up to 700, 800 ppm. And the increase of the temperature will be not 2 degrees as agreed in Paris, but will be close to 5 degrees. And it will be a tremendous problem. So we are not allowed to follow, let's say, business as usual scenario for the energy consumption. And also, if you try really to forecast the future energy consumption, take into account not only climatic change, but all the other parameters I just shown you before, for example, the floor area, with a low scenario, an average and a high scenario, and also the cooling consumption per person, the temperature increase, 1 degree, 2 degrees, 3 degrees, the penetration of the new equipment, the increase of the efficiency, and so on, and also the improvement of the efficiency of buildings because we are able to build better buildings, then we may have three scenarios, a low development scenario, an average and a high development scenario for the residential, for the commercial buildings. And the forecast actually shows that this is the actual energy consumption. For 2050, this is the expecting energy consumption in the commercial sector. The average for the low, let's say, scenario, 200% the minimum. For the average scenario, we expect something close to 280. And for the high scenario, something close to 360. But this is without the externalities, without any, let's say, specific effects that may happen, without, let's say, any surprises. If the elasticities are taken into account, then the expected increase may go up to 465%. In the next 30 years, the energy consumption in the commercial, area and commercial sector will increase, let's say, 5 times. And if the same exercise happens also for the residential sector, you will be terrified to see that the expected, let's say, increase of the energy consumption in the residential sector will be of the order of magnitude of 2,270 without taking into account the externalities. When the externalities are taken into account, unfortunately, the increase will be of this order of magnitude. So the question is very clear. Where is the energy? What is the cost of the future energy? What is going to happen with emissions and so on? You may not believe, let's say, the predictions I showed you before. So I plotted all the existing predictions from all around the world, from United Nations, from all the countries, etc. And these are the predictions. Let's say the more, let's say, optimum solution, optimum prediction and forecast predicts an increase of the energy consumption by 2050 of the order of magnitude of 300%. This is the average, 700%. And this is, let's say, the very high one. We are somewhere here. So this is the reality. This is exactly the reality. This is the actual situation about energy. Let's move to the second, let's say, topic, climatic change. Is it a problem? What really happens with climate change around the globe? I really tried to put together all the existing information about, let's say, climatic change and temperature increase in Asia and Australia. And the problem is that we have increased temperatures, but also climatic change is not the increase of the temperature. It has to do also with the higher frequency of the heat waves. It has to do with the duration of the hot spells, which is increasing, and also the intensity of the heat island. For example, if you plot the hot spells between 1955 to our days, you will see what's happened during the very last years. Also, if you try really to plot the duration of the hot spells above, let's say, 37 degrees, very high temperature, the red spots, and the blue, 40 degrees, very, very high, just look what is happening during the very last years. So climatic change is there. Also, the problem associated with the increase of the temperature of our cities is huge. And these are data that I have collected from all, let's say, from 110 Asian and Australian cities. And you may realize that the amplitude, the average amplitude of the urban heat island is of the order of magnitude of about 5 degrees, which means that our cities, and these are measured data, this is not going to happen in the future. This is what is happening actually. The average increase of the Asian, of the temperature in Asian and Australian cities is close to 5 degrees. And this has a tremendous energy penalty. According to all the measured data, the energy increase because of the urban heat island, because of the increase of the cities, of the temperature in our cities, is of the order of magnitude of 23%. So the penalty we are paying actually is 23% because of the temperature increase in our cities. And I don't like really to give you more about the penalties of the future climatic change. I hate really to make, let's say, forecast given the predictions I showed you before. But it's not just energy. Climatic change, it is associated with many other problems. And it increases the vulnerability, you know, of the low-income people. This slide presents the temperature in indoor temperature in about 150 low-income houses during a heat wave. These guys didn't have the possibility to have an air conditioner. I just remind you that we have 200 million energy poor in Europe. And you see that before the heat wave, temperature was quite comfortable, 26, 27 degrees. At the end of the heat wave, the average temperature was 33, 34 degrees. But you may see that many, let's say, residences and houses, they live under, let's say, 38, 39 degrees. And the more important is that we had spells of about 250 hours above 33 degrees. And you may tell me, so what? Climatic change and increased temperature have a tremendous impact on health. All studies we have shows that above a threshold temperature, which is for the southern countries, I mean for the warm climates, it is close to 30 degrees, mortality, here is mortality, is increasing exponentially. And this is valid for, let's say, the warm countries, but also for cold countries, for example, London, Stockholm, etc. The threshold temperature is much lower, it's 23 degrees. So I had many times several people, I'm allowed to say stupid people, saying that global warming is fantastic for the northern countries. You know, temperature will increase. No, mortality will increase because the adaptation is not the same. Because, you know, at the problem of mortality is increasing exponentially in the northern climates at much lower temperatures. So you understand the tremendous cost that is associated with climatic change and health. I don't like to give you predictions about the future number, let's say, of heat-related mortality. You will be terrified. And let's move to the third parameter that has to do with the energy poverty. What is energy poverty? Energy poverty is the situation in which a household, a family, lacks a socially and materially necessitated level of energy services in the home. This is important. They cannot really heat their homes. They cannot really cool their homes. They cannot afford to pay for energy. It has a tremendous impact on the quality of life of the citizens, which of course affects the indoor climatic position, but also it affects highly the social attainments and the health. And it is very much associated with many combined factors. And especially it is, associated with the insufficient family income, the poor quality and the low size of the houses, the possible high energy prices, and many other demographic drivers. It's a very complicated problem. And there are many issues that have to be considered. And I'm sorry for this complicated slide, but really I wish to show you the main, let's say, drivers that affect the energy poverty. And this has to do with the state of the economy. For example, in Greece before, let's say, the crisis, energy poverty was 3%. 2 years after the crisis, energy poverty was 32%. Second, it has to do with income, which is very much affected with the state of the economy. It has to do with the market system. It has to do with the policy framework, how we support these guys, and also it has to do with the sociopolitical system in the country. And of course, this is very much related with the physical infrastructure. And I mean the building stock, the condition of the building stock. It has to do also with, let's say, the supply choice, how really we offer energy to the people, how they can buy, the energy, the network access, if they have access to the energy. And for sure, this has a very important impact on the whole policy and the policy intervention of the country. And this has to do with the social support, with the direct energy and the payment support, with the social tariffs and so on. And I don't like really to mention more. And this is very much affected by the energy services, the demand and the expenditure, but really like to go to the impact. And the impact, it is really very important. Of course, it has to do with, let's say, an important impact on health of these people. It has to do with the social stigma. But the more important, it has to do, let's say, with the mental well-being. Just to understand, schizophrenia in Europe is 0.2% of the whole population. For the low-income people, schizophrenia is 17%. So it has a very important impact, let's say, on the well-being of people. And of course, this is very much associated with the satisfaction of the population. United Nations published, let's say, this graph that shows, for example, how the fraction of dissatisfied population is affected, let's say, by the income. And for sure, the lower, let's say, the income, the lower the satisfaction. And you may ask me, do we have enough, do we have a lot of energy poor in the world? Yes, we have. And this is a graph I have prepared just to show you the official number of energy poor, official number. In the United States, we have 46 million. In South America, 250 million. In Europe, more than 100 million. The European Parliament announced quite recently that the total number of, let's say, energy poor is more than 150 million people. Just to give you a number, 75% of the Portuguese cannot afford to heat their house. Also, in Africa and Asia, 1.1 billion. And, these numbers are very high. Unfortunately, we don't have data from Australia. And why this is associated with energy and with climate change? Because, first of all, to solve the problem of energy poverty, we have really to design proper houses, a deep retrofitting. But how? Are we allowed to spend a lot of money for the retrofitting of the social, let's say, housing? No, we have to spend as much as less, for the cost. The budget has to be very low. So we have really to define policies and technologies to satisfy the demand for low-income houses. This is actually the situation in the three sectors. And let's discuss about, let's say, the future. The three problems I have presented you opens a really fantastic opportunity gap. Why? Because these three problems are very highly interrelated. And there are very strong synergies between them. And we have to explore the multiple and the complex synergies between them. And also, we have to reply to very fundamental questions in order really to discuss about this opportunity gap. And the more fundamental question is, well, what do we have to do? What have to be the quantitative and the qualitative future targets for each of these problems in concern? What really we expect to do in the future? We know the problems. We know that we will increase the energy consumption by 2,000%, which is the target for 2050. Decrease it by 10%, 20%, 80%. We know that we have, let's say, 2 billion of energy poor, which is the target for 2050. We know that we may expect an increase of the temperature by 3 or 4 degrees by 2050, which is our target. Second important question, it has to do with the major technological, macroeconomical, social forces and the trends which define the progress and the development of the immediate future that will impact the economy, the sustainable advancements and the societies. So we have to define which kind of technology we like to use, which kind of economy we like to use, how really we may move to the specific targets we just defined, the roadmap to the future. Third, and this is the more important of, let's say, the questions, how we may transform the problems, the challenges, into opportunities. And how really we can increase the added value of the technological, the economic, the social interventions to generate wealth and other employment opportunities. We have the problem. We have to solve the problem. Is this the driver for the future development and how this has to be done? And last, how we can really define new proper mechanism to change the present status, which will define a more proactive than a more, let's say, reactive agenda, and will have an impact on the energy consumption of buildings, the local and global climatic change, and the energy poverty. So the question is very clear. The problem is here. It is well known. We have very good forecast for the future. We need really to offer a solution. But how? And which technology? Which policy? And how this will open an opportunity for the future, for future development? And let's go through the different technologies we have. And let's start with the energy consumption. We know very well that in the future, by 2050, three will be the main sectors that will affect the energy consumption from the technological point of view in the building domain. Renewable energy sources, smart technologies, future cities. These are the three issues. 99% of the energy is associated with the three issues. But the main question is, do we have the technology really to decrease the energy consumption by 2050? Yes, we have the technology. The problem is not there. The problem is the cost of the technology. If we plot actually the cost of the technologies regarding the expected energy conservation, you may see that we are able, with a reasonable cost, to decrease the energy consumption of the building domain by 40%. This is what we can do. If we like, really, to decrease the energy consumption of the building sector by 80%, and this is what we agreed in Paris, for example, then we have to invest in this kind of technologies. And these technologies are 3, 4, 5 times more expensive. So the future agenda about the energy developments in the building sector have to do with this area. And countries that will invest and will make and perform research in this area will be the leaders of the future. Those that they are interested only to work on this part, just installing photovoltaics everywhere, for example, they will not have any future because the developments will be here and the future will be here. And let's try to be a little bit more specific and try to convince you with very detailed numbers. Actually, for example, we have to implement three types of policies in the building sector. First of all, we have to increase the global energy efficiency of the building sector and really decrease the load, more energy efficiency, number one priority. Number two, we have to use renewables, substitute, let's say, the conventional energy sources. And third, better management, more intelligent systems. These are the three simple, let's say, strategies we have to employ in the future. Is there any specific, let's say, interest around these technologies? Of course. According, let's say, to the International Energy Agency, although there are important improvements regarding the implementation of the use of energy efficiency technologies, 65% of the economic potential of the energy efficient technologies remains untapped, which means that we have a tremendous potential for further energy efficiency. And just to understand the order of magnitude, because we discussed before about the opportunities, in 2013, the global market of the energy efficient products was something close to 285 billion euros. And this was 33% of the global market. The energy efficient buildings, it had a share of 126 billion euros. And the market of energy appliance was something close to 100, let's say, 83 billions, and it is expected to increase by 5,007 billions. But in 2050, this budget will increase to 1.365 trillions. So the market is there. The market is there. And those that invest in this part of the curve I showed you before, smart technologies, etc., they will benefit from let's say, the future market. And if you try really to be more specific and try really to understand the future of appliances and lighting, you will see that the numbers will increase tremendously in the next year. And the increases are expected to be of the order of magnitude of about 200-300%. Or if we try really to see, let's say, cutting edge technologies for the envelope, and I mean, for example, smart glass. Smart glass was something close to 76, let's say, million euros, and will increase to 2.7 billion euros by 2020. So the market is there, and someone has really to use it. The same, for example, for advanced insulation materials. The same for, let's say, advanced phase change technologies. And the same for HVAC technologies. And the same for PV systems. I'm not really giving you the numbers because I don't really to stay in the specific numbers. And I like really to stay and discuss a little bit about the intelligent systems. I told you that the future market of intelligent products will be something close to 1.3 trillion, let's say, American dollars by 2050. Smart grid technologies and smart supply technologies will represent about 30% of the future market. You understand, let's say, the potential of future developments on the building sector. So it's a tremendous sector that really asks for new developments, ask for new industrial products, and those that they will invest in it will really benefit from the whole, let's say, development. So I don't like really to consider more the numbers, and I think that I have convinced you about the potential. But I like to give you the global numbers. We have agreed in Paris that by 2050, we will decrease the energy consumption of the building sector by 80%. How? By investing and use the technologies that I just shown you before. Which is the cost of the total, let's say, refurbishment of the building sector in Europe? 12 to 16 trillion euros. And which is going to be the cost, let's say, of the 80% reduction of the energy consumption by 2050 in the world? Between 55 to 90 trillion of euros. This is the real number. And there are many questions associated with, let's say, this kind of investment. At the same time, if we really wish to achieve the targets set by the Paris Conference and decrease the CO2 by, let's say, 80-90%, this is the number we have really to invest. But the more important is that the building sector is labor intensive. And for every million of euros, let's say, invested in the building sector, we have about 19 new jobs. So in case that we follow the Paris recommendation, we expect that we'll have 30 to 55 million new jobs per year. These are the prospects of the building sector. This is the future. This is the challenge for the building sector. This is what we have to do for the future. But it's not only to decrease the energy consumption of the building sector. We have to improve, let's say, our cities. We have to fight climatic change. And we know, for example, that there is a huge research that is carried out trying really to mitigate the climatic change. And there are several technologies that have been proposed. And the more important technologies are associated with the development, let's say, of reflective materials like infrared reflective coatings, PCM nanomaterials, highly reflective asphaltic materials, thermochromic intelligent materials, and many other materials. I will go through to show you that we have the technology and really we can mitigate the urban heat island and the climatic change. And actually we have developed, for example, white materials that compared to the conventional white materials present about 20 degrees lower surface temperature. And this can mitigate highly the urban heat in our cities. Also, we have, let's say, cool colored materials. We have black colored materials, black cool materials, materials that present very low temperature. And at the same time, these materials may, let's say, mitigate the urban heat island. You see, for example, a cool black tile and, let's say, a conventional one. You see that between the two, you have about 20 degrees of temperature difference. Exactly the same thing, because they are reflecting in the infrared. Or, let's say, the blue tiles. You see the temperature difference. And also, we have new materials that change the color as a function of temperature. For example, thermochromic materials, which are used now in the urban environment, may be blue, black, whatever color you may wish, at low temperature, and became white when temperature increases, so they are much more reflecting, and then they became again blue, black, whatever, when temperature decreases. And these materials present about, let's say, 21 degrees lower temperature. And if you don't believe me, just see, for example, the thermal camera picture of the thermochromic black against the cool black and against the common black. You see that 21 degrees lower temperature. So by using these materials, we can really mitigate the urban heat. Also, we're not using any more black asphalt in our streets and in our pavements. We have developed very reflecting, excellent, let's say, asphaltic materials that you may see, for example, different asphaltic materials. This is the conventional one, and this is, let's say, the cool one, 35 degrees lower temperature. At the same time, we have advanced technologies, for example, PV thermoelectric materials that may decrease or increase the temperature of the area. Here is when the temperature is increasing, or here is the temperature when the temperature is decreasing, as a function of the weather. So you may have, let's say, a warm pavement without spending any energy, or you may have, let's say, a cool pavement. And these technologies have been developed and are mature and have been, let's say, already installed. And you may ask me, how many applications you have? Hundreds, thousands of applications around the world. And from the monitoring of the existing mitigation technologies, we know that by increasing a little bit, let's say, the albedo of our cities, we may decrease the temperature of our cities up to 1 degree, the average temperature. And you may ask me, can you show us one picture, one project? This is the first European, let's say, prize award of environmental quality. And it has to do with the mitigation of, let's say, a park, a coastal park in Athens. This was the temperature before, this is the temperature after. This is monitored for the last 4 years through satellites. We have decreased the temperature in a park let's say by 2.3 degrees, 1.5 in average, with very low cost, let's say, technologies. And actually we know, because we have developed all these technologies, that we are able, by using different, let's say, type of technologies, to decrease, let's say, the surface temperature and also the ambient temperature up to, let's say, 7-8 degrees. And also we know the potential of the different type of technologies that may be used, or the combination of the different type of technologies. And also we know for all type of technologies how really we can decrease the temperature of our cities. So technology is here. As in the case of the energy consumption of buildings, the mitigation technology is here. But the problem is not the availability of technology. The problem, it has to do, let's say, with the cost. How much we need to implement the well-known mitigation technologies? According to the calculations we have performed, we need something close to $3-4 trillion. But this will create 1,700,000, let's say, new jobs per year. This is the second opportunity for the building sector. I'd like to conclude. I tried to went through, let's say, the main problems we are facing. I try really to give you the main characteristics of the energy consumption of the building sector, local and global climatic change, energy poverty. And I tried also to show you the main drivers that define the future. And the conclusion is that we expect a tremendous energy consumption for the future because of the reasons I have described. We expect also a very high increase of the temperature, unfortunately, with tremendous impact on health, mainly on health. The main discussion of the future concerning the building sector will not be energy, will be health. And also we have a tremendous problem of energy poverty. These three sectors are strongly interrelated. We are not allowed to isolate them. We need to have an holistic approach. And now the idea is coming. Innovating to zero. What is innovating to zero? It is, let's say, an idea that tries to minimize the energy consumption of the buildings and decrease by 80%. This is what we agreed in Paris, that by 2050 we will decrease the energy consumption by 80% if we like to have the 2 degrees of temperature increase. Second, eradication of the energy poverty, especially in the developed countries. It is, let's say, ridiculous for the developed countries to have 200 million of energy poor. We can eradicate easily the energy poverty. This is a very clear target for 2050. And finally, we have to mitigate the urban heat island. We have to decrease the temperature of our cities. Is it realistic? Yes, it is realistic. The idea of innovating to zero means low energy consumption, 80% decrease, no energy poverty, no climatic change in our cities. Such an objective, it is very ambitious, for sure. And I fully agree that it is ambitious. And in my opinion, it is a choice that we have to follow. And we have to follow because such a choice creates tremendous, let's say, opportunities for the future growth, and at the same time will alleviate the population from the consequences of the energy consumption, the climatic change, and let's say energy poverty. But the more important, will offer short, medium, and long-term benefits and opportunities. Policies that can be applied to, let's say, decrease drastically the energy efficiency of the building sector, to mitigate the local and the global climatic change, to eradicate the energy poverty, offers tremendous potential for growth and future development and prosperity. We have to invest about, let's say, 100 and something trillions to achieve the targets we have agreed in Paris. Think about it. Think how these investments can be done. Which kind of research has to be carried out? Which political systems has to be applied? how this money have to be distributed. The more important is not just to achieve the technological target. The more important is not to decrease the energy consumption by 80%. It's not to decrease the energy poverty. It's not just to decrease climatic change. It's really to use this roadmap, this, let's say, effort on the benefit of the global population. Why? Because actually we have a substantial economic inequalities in the world. And the future investment, these 100 trillion by 2050, should target to diminish the economic disparities and discriminations. Why? Because for, let's say, actually for each euro that goes to the poorest population from the construction sector, 168 euros have to be produced in the global economy. Which means that construction has to invest 166 euros or dollars just to move or transfer 1 euro or dollar to the low-income population. Which means that the whole budget of the construction sector stays in the upper level. So in case that we agreed that we will spend 100 trillion in the future, we have to be sure that this will be distributed in, let's say, a proper and fair way and will not increase, let's say, the discriminations. Otherwise, we risk really to have a future world without a high energy consumption, without, let's say, climatic change, but with, let's say, 50-60% of the population very poor. And just to give you an example, the actual, let's say, official policy of the European Union that forecast that by 2050 we have to invest 26 trillion to decrease the energy consumption of the building sector, it says clearly that actually in 2015 households in Europe spent 13% of their income for energy. When we are spending 26 trillion and we decrease the energy consumption by 80%, the share of the cost of the energy, let's say, for the European household in 2050 will be 18%. Why? Because the cost of the energy will increase. And why the cost of the energy will increase? Because of the investments. So in case that we spend all this money really are distributed to some people, and they really increase inequalities in the world, this is something that we have to avoid. So this is my last slide. For sure, such an ambitious goal will be achieved gradually and will be associated with major technological breakthrough. To achieve such a goal, we need to have a lot of research and serious and targeted research. It's not enough just to substitute part of our load with photovoltaics, with wind farms, and so on. We need really to invest in serious technological research. It is evident that the definition and the implementation of a clear, ambitious, and holistic and multi-phase vision of the future is really imperative. Thank you very much.